all settled in, we'll get started. Call to order, the Wednesday, January 6th, special work session for City Hall discussion. Approval of the agenda.
Move to approve the agenda for this night's session.
A second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Okay. Bruce, you want to start us off?
Sir, thank you. There were two questions that have been asked, and I wanted to address those first with some information. And then, Mr. Mayor, you and I had a conversation about what we might want to try to accomplish tonight. And if you want to elaborate at all, I think we were talking about trying to make sure that the council agreed on what the problem or the opportunity we were trying to take care of or the problem we're trying to solve, to make sure that everybody, before we start talking about the solution we agree on, do we agree on what we're trying to take care of? So I think that might be from the follow-up discussion. There are copies of a document like this that are out there. It's in the bottom of the shelf. And this has to do with questions that were raised about the cost of the project. And the cost of the project, what would it be if it was just today versus the projections that we're looking at and how that would work out? And so if you look at the top and what the relative square footages would be for City Hall A, City Hall B, South Wind A, and South Wind B, the direct construction cost would range between $302 and $315 per square foot. And then because we have special foundation considerations, and you can see they're pretty significant at this point for South Wind, and I don't believe these numbers include the cost if there's a need to adjust for lateral forces. I believe these are just the axial forces or those going down because of clay and some other materials, vegetative materials in the soil. So there's a significant difference between those two sites. and then you ask for a cost for the resiliency items, which include generators, solar, wind, electric, all those things, to keep the building operational at all times. And then contractor markup, which is is not something you would normally have. I guess you have it to a smaller degree in a smaller construction project, but that's based on the cost of the overall project, and so that's why if you have more elements going in up at South Wind, that's why that cost would be higher than it would under option A downtown. So there's just not as many things happening there. And then this estimated cost is significant because we don't have a design yet. And so when we're talking about the cost that we have, that there's actually a number going across there, which is 15% of the cost on everything that is above the line there. So those are the costs that we have. So the cost of the building in today's dollars, option A, which is the one story here on Gower, would be about 7.7 million. It's 8.8 million for option B, which is the two-story here on Gower. South Wind A, the building itself is 9.3 for the, without the extra utilities, it would be just enough to take care of City Hall Police Station. And then when you add the utilities for, I think we sized it for 40 units, and then also school requirements for the school, that would bring the costs up to $9.3 million. And then there's additional costs, which would include the cost for site work, which are relatively the same across, although they are slightly different or slightly lower for South Wind. The cost for roadway and utilities are available in the City Hall option A and B, and that's where a significant cost difference is. It's $8.2 million if it's just for the City Hall and the police station. It goes up significantly if it's going to add the utilities for other facilities up there yet to be named. And then we're talking about escalation out to April 2021. And I think that was about 5%, 6% a year. And so, again, it's based on the cost of the project. And so it's going to be higher for South Wind than it would be for the downtown location. And then there were the list of soft costs that we've talked about before. And that that's where the projects get up to, you know, 14, and then that costs design, a bunch of other elements. So that's why the City Hall Option A, which is the one story, is $14.7 million, out to about 2 years, $16.2 million for City Hall B, which is the two-story, $29 million for South Wind, which is the City Hall, and the police station. And then we incorporate the utilities for the school. It goes up to 29.6. So those are the relative costs. And there's a listing of each what each element costs per square foot and adds into the price. So hopefully that provides a comparison to any construction costs or things that you're hearing, you know, going on now. And to kind of explain some of the costs that we have in here, Nancy had asked me to make sure I was able to explain the difference between what's required in Category 2 and what's required in Category 4. And I guess the bottom line on it is a Category 2 is built strong enough that if we were to have an earthquake or something, that it would be, you would have time to get out of the building. So it allowed that, but it's not necessarily going to stand up. The Category 4 is intended to stand up through the whole event. If you're inside, you're, you know, you don't have to leave in order to be safe. And at the end of it, it should be somewhat operational. If you try to maintain that the systems, the comms, power, all those kind of things, you could try to design it so that those things would remain operational immediately after the event. So you can imagine what the cost differences would be in trying to provide the structure for that versus something that the only goal in an event is to be able to get people out of the building. And if I can, when we're talking about you know, comparing, I was talking to David Veneta, and it kind of came up that this is a probably a category 0.2.
0.2?
Because there was really nothing in the structure of this building that indicates that there was any desire that this thing was to stand up under any sort of an adverse condition. It was built to be, you know, garage space and storage space, and so there are really no elements to try to even get it to Category 1 or Category 2. The only thing I have found is that I thought that there was a couple of braces over here and the other side of the wall. It looks like the wall is holding up the roof. And someone that's been here for a while pointed out to me, no, actually that roof is holding up that wall. So I don't know if there's any questions beyond that. Does that answer your question, Nancy?
I think it does.
Or 2 and 4?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And this, all these are based on 4?
Yes.
Asking.
All these costs are based on a Category 4.
Okay. And is there any state requirement that city halls be built to Category 4?
Not city hall itself, but if you incorporate the police station, then it becomes Category 4.
And that is a state? That is a state requirement, state building code.
Well, I can't tell you the state, it may be federal. I don't know what the requirement but it, there comes is. A, from. But yes.
There is a law. Okay.
Yeah, it goes to the higher of the two.
I have a question on the cost for site work. It says including parking lots and utilities related to the building. I was wondering why the... I guess it'd be the first two cases, why they are more expensive than parking lots and related utilities for the buildings on Southwind are cheaper. Does it mean we're going to have fewer parking spaces?
I think there's more site work.
I think from what I noticed in the SRG's drawings is that they were including the moving of the parking lot up to this space.
Yes.
So
it'd be the demolition of this number. And then the new parking lot and all that.
And then there would be curbing and stuff like that would be a little more extensive than what would be happening.
Than just grading and asphalt up there.
Would you have less of it to move in if you're building a two-story building? Mm-hmm. You're not displacing so much down on the lower section.
Thanks.
questions for Bruce?
Not at this point.
When Bruce and I were talking the other morning, I was kind of thinking that maybe we need to step back a little bit and kind of readdress our reasoning behind why we're doing this. Kind of frame the problem so we're clear that we're all on the same page. What is specifically the problems? Maybe there's more than one. Not yet trying to solve the problem, but just at least so we know what the problem is. That being, obviously, this building is a problem. That's my first kind of a, we know it's in a bad spot, we know it's on bad ground, and it's just poorly built and old. So that would be as the fact that we need a new city hall. I think what we've done is we've piled on top of this the fact that we have Southwind. We purchased Southwind specifically for critical and essential uses. The school or the academy and emergency uses specifically. So that was a natural to just all of a sudden say, okay, we need a new city hall. We've got a spot that is available land for critical and essential. Seemed like an obvious solution. Obviously, it's not that easy. And it's getting more and more expensive the longer we wait. So I guess I'm just brainstorming here. We need to step back and say, what are the issues that relate to our concern for finding ourselves a new city hall? And I'm hoping this would be kind of an open discussion. And we're not trying to solve any problems tonight. We're just trying to figure out what is, why we're looking at such dramatic numbers. That seems kind of obvious because that's how much things cost these days, I guess. I think there's still some debate as to whether we can find a middle ground.
I guess, as I looked at this, you're right. We've kind of hit it from a bunch of different directions, and it's evolved over time. And started off with Southwind, it's kind of an emergency, and we're going to do that. And we're going to put the utilities in the school. And, gee, this is a problem here. But I guess I tried to, in my mind, prioritize, and I felt like addressing our ability to cover after a significant event is a very important problem to solve, and we're not going to be able to do that with the way we are now, no matter how you look at it, I don't think. I look also on, and I don't know how many people have had the opportunity to go through our police station, but it's embarrassing, actually. So I felt, okay, if we're going to do something, even without these other things, I think we need to do something about the police station. There is, not addressing site and location. And then, as we look at that, I'm thinking safety for the city hall personnel, just a safe place to work. And I'm not talking about just in the event of a building shake, an earthquake, but good healthy air to breathe, fire suppression systems, blow for emergency, and even convenience of working relationships between departments. We could make that work. But more than anything else, I think about the safety expecting people to work in this building, we all know it's really unsafe. And if there was a quake, just discussed, this place won't survive, and probably the people won't have time to get out. That'd be the concern. And then, ultimately, we got to have, whatever we do, we have to have the ability to finance it, the ability to raise a bond, and a willingness of the citizens to meet that requirement. That's kind of the way I look at all of this process through. And none of that addresses location, well, maybe the ability to bond might, the cost, certainly the cost is a big part of it. And if looking at some of the different options, we have to say, well, you know, like going from Hemlock site A to B, we gain safety, the second story of some tsunami, and you're paying a little bit more. Right? So you're paying a premium to have a safer place to be. When you go up Southwind, same thing. You're paying a premium to have something that's even more likely to be even a safer facility. Are we willing to pay, we as citizens, are we willing to pay that premium for the added safety and offset? I think there's an inconvenience of that, but that's not a cost. Those are my comments.
Good. I'm just comparing those to my list. I had a couple on here that are kind of minor additions to what Mike has said. One of them that to me was critical when we start looking at the Gower Street sites is that there is no aggregate loss of parking. It should at least stay the same, if not more. I think that's important. One of the things that I've been running into ever since SRG started with their first options is the conflict between having City Hall in the center of town. I think is very important, but it's in a danger spot. And so I'm still, I cannot decide myself on the fact that it's I want that community aspect of being in the center of town, but having it here in the inundation zone really concerns me. I don't have an answer for that one yet. It's still a problem.
Tim, I've got some interesting information on that, and Jeff had done some research on his own. And Jeff, is it 48 cities or communities on the coast? 48 communities on the coast, and all except two of them have a place in their city that they could move to that is out of the inundation zone. The two cities that do not are the city of Cannon Beach and the city of Seaside. The difference between us and them is Seaside has land adjacent to the city that they could annex and build out of the tsunami zone. We, other than going to Southwind and, you know, paying the upcharge for the dealing with some of the issues there, we really don't. We're kind of between a rock and a hard place. Either we're either going to be here or we're going to pay a significant cost kind of outside the city, but still for the conditions that are there to be able to do that. Everybody else has got other options.
Well, Seaside's already up on the hill with facilities. Hospital, the housing developments that are up there, they've got service.
Right, we're talking about the City Hall itself, though. They could move to the place. It would, but not in the city, just adjacent, and then to annex it. We don't have that. And everybody else does, so it's kind of a unique problem that we're facing.
Jeff, wouldn't Gearhart also be in that same situation?
Gearhart, no. Gearhart has land within its city limits.
Would have to be east of the highway, though, right?
Yeah, well, you know, I caution if you use a general term, because I did, looking at the large T-shirt area, so not the XL, XXL, and so on that standard, and then I looked at
that the GAMI, when they were in the, which is the Department of
Geology and Mineral Industries,
that kind of talks about, you know, what the tsunami zones are and all those kind of things. Just to make it simple, they said that they used the threat, potential threat, as t-shirt size. So, you know, there's the, if it's a small tsunami, you've got a small shirt. Medium, it would go up to this point, all the way up to extra large. So when we're talking about the south wind qualifies as one that is outside of the extra large. But for sake of people understanding it, even I understood it, that's how they based it on t-shirt size. Thanks.
So we still don't have the study on the stability of the ground up at south wind?
We have the study as far as the forces downward, you know, what the ability of the site to take weight. What we're still waiting on, and we maybe by next Wednesday we'll have it, but what the potential lateral forces are from a landslide either under the building or above. And that would add costs to the numbers that we have here. What these numbers address are the pilings that go down like 65 feet or whatever, 4 foot diameter, to go ahead and take care of the downward force.
Did we get Tom Horney involved?
No, we have not talked to Tom yet.
Okay.
My intention is to provide him with the material.
So I suppose it's possible that there would, that the vertical 65 foot, 4 foot diameter pilings may be sufficient to withstand the slide. I mean,
well, no, not to withstand the slide. It won't withstand the slide. It won't
at all.
The downward. Okay. What they're trying to determine is, you know, based on the borings that they did, is what are the likelihoods of movement and where would those occur? And so when, if there is going to be movement, then there has to be something done in the site itself and then also possibly above the site in order to stabilize it so it doesn't come down. But we have half the information on it.
Okay. Trying to get back to me, the big question about the difference between Gower Street and South Wind. One of my, as I was thinking about this, one of my solutions was the splitting City Hall, literally taking part of the activity of City Hall, leaving it here, and taking the other part and putting it up on South Wind. That is a a challenging option, understandably, from operations. Not probably any cheaper than any of the other options, because we'd still have to consider access and stuff like that. But it answered the only, it was the only way I could find an answer for having the chambers and front desk still being downtown, and then other operations up in the safe zone, creating a an emergency capable facility. That was just another option that we have not really had any discussion over from SRG. I could elaborate more on that.
Well, one of the suggestions was putting some of that up at the public works yard, and which is nearly then get the expense of moving public work somewhere else. And that they're taking a look at it, I happen to look up.
That's the other problem.
Oh, my God. There are all our feeder lines. The big substation is right there, and it all goes right straight across there, I'm sure, right away. That looks like an expensive proposition. So I got back in my car and left.
Well, and Seaside has separated those areas, I think. So
as what?
The planning department is in a different location than City Hall.
Mm-hmm.
So be interesting to know if they think it's a problem.
It's planning, isn't it? Planning and Public Works is in one location.
Yeah.
Quite a bit distant from the City Hall.
Right.
And then the police station is also separated from.
Yes.
I don't know how that works. I don't know. Wynn Stanley would be able to tell us, but I don't know how that all works in terms of communication and coordination and so forth.
Talk to the assistant city manager, and he doesn't like it.
I did a
very inconvenient.
I did just a really brief little informal research, and there's very few cities that are walking on the coast.
I think that when we started out, we were trying to nail down the problem that we were trying to solve so that we could evaluate options against that later. And just want to point out that it sounds like we're talking about solutions. Mm-hmm. So if you want to get it back, that's great, but I now won't speak up again. That was a little bit far afield from where we started.
Keep us on our toes. I think, to me, one of my sore points is the fact that we purchased Southwind quite some time ago now and have not been able to make any advance on it at all. That, I guess, when this came up and I saw the possibility of getting the utilities and the road established up there, that was important, just to get that started. Whenever I look at this, I see this as two separate projects. Getting Southwind available and accessible, and a city hall. At some point, if we're determined enough to do that, to get Southwind as a usable piece of property, it's going to cost just as much as it does now, or even more. So at some point, we're going to have to do that, or we're going to have to ask the folks of Cannon Beach if they want to do that. A couple of people have asked me, could we do a survey or a poll or some sort of questionnaire in advance of a bond so that we could say, hey, here's several items. Which ones are important to you? And we've had the survey for the strategic plan. It answered some of the questions, but not specifically having dollar amounts behind it. Where this actually would show that. If people were willing to say, whatever it is, $9 million for roadway and utilities at Southwind. Boom. Ask that first. If they're not willing to go forward with that, then we're on a totally different page. That's just, unless, rather than going to all the work and putting the bond forward for, that measure, I guess.
I agree. I think the community should be behind whatever bond measure we choose to support.
Well, to get back to the conversation about why we're doing this in the first place, I think my major concern is that this city hall, whether we have an event or not, is eventually going to fall down around us. So I guess I'm very concerned about getting something safe, not only for the people who work here now, but for if we do have an event, making sure that we have the ability to build back again. And I'm not sure this building will do that. So that's one of the things that I'm concerned about. I'm also concerned about, and I have been for a long time, where we're going to put people who do survive a tsunami and how we're going to house them. And I don't think we're going to house them in the city hall, of course, but we have to think about where we're going to place them. And I think the original thought was building some kind of a rudimentary, anyway, facility up on South Wind, not even maybe a facility, but some area that we can minister to people who do survive and can make their way to South Wind after an earthquake and tsunami. So those are my two concerns. I think that would be the reason that I would want to have a new city hall. Now, I'm not talking about location. I'm just talking about the reason why we might need to replace the city hall. Because this, if you keep pouring money into this, it's just going to be a wasted effort. We have too many needs that this building doesn't fulfill. And we don't know. You can talk about putting a new roof on it, but we have absolutely no idea what's under or in any of these walls other than sawdust. And I think it's like remodeling a home. You think you're going to fix one problem, and you find out you have 15 others. And I have a feeling we're going to find out we have a lot more problems with this city hall than we just look at now.
Well, that's been the experience with some of the remodeling that has been done already. Just the restrooms and the kitchen area is a much bigger problem. I guess I've always, again, this isn't a problem, but it addresses the Southland comment. Always felt, and what Nancy just said, that it made sense, regardless of the city hall and police station and all that stuff. To me, it always made sense to have a, say, inexpensive structure, just a big steel building. I think we saw proposals for something like almost tent-like structures or fiberglass, but just a industrial steel building that we could store emergency equipment in, store tents in, store cook stoves, store porta-johns, maybe have some of our public works equipment there, the big front-end loader and the dump truck, the big stuff, and first aid supplies and water and those things. I think having that up there would not require a fancy 101 interchange. It wouldn't require major utilities. We have to really bring water from the spring or bring water from the reservoir if still standing. But it would be a place, like to address what Nancy's talking about. But that's independent of what we're talking about here. But it is another one of those needs that goes back to what Sam was saying. There that would be a use, and in my mind, a useful purpose for Southland. Well, they have to go back up in the slide area down here where the tanks and the helicopter pad is. And I know that's an inundation for anything above the, I guess, the large size T-shirt. Anyway. So I don't think we have to say it.
Well, I would say that clearly the building needs to be replaced, and beyond that, you know, we're going to have to come up with something, and whether it's what's presented before us right now or, you know, rethinking that, I don't think using this building is an option at all. And in terms of moving this forward, how do we feel as a council about using the information presented to us, or is it that we feel that we need to think of something else that just costs less? Because it seems to be what we keep talking about, but nobody seems to have. I'm not sure, you you know, building another building somewhere else to, in order to, you know, allow us to build a Category 2 building, there's going to be a cost associated with that. The more I look at it, the more I see this as a real economic reality. That, you know, it's going to cost a lot of money, and we're going to have to decide whether that's feasible for this community or not.
That kind of goes to Mike's fourth point about the ability to finance it. I could, my sense is even at the 14,000 one-story option, it wouldn't pass. So I'm, you know, I have no problem with just saying, okay, go for the bond, see what happens. It just isn't going to pass.
Mm-hmm.
That's. So at that point, we get back to the problem. Yes, we all understand, and we all, I think, see that this building is not going to make it, not going to survive anything, let alone the next 10 years, probably. So until we find a way to present a new city hall that is reasonable, it's not going to pass. My sense of it. Now, we can try and push it, and we can try get out there and stump for it, I guess. But I don't know how that goes.
Well, clearly we need to, whatever we do, we've got to make the facts available and let the voters decide. And maybe it's presumption to me to say that there's going to decide it's worth an extra $9 million or whatever it is to go to Southland. But it should be, my perspective, that should just be taken off the table. Robin said, well, maybe I'll let the voters decide whether it's worth it or not. But what do you present to them? We can't just say you want a building or not, or you got to present something. Are we going to flesh out every one of these and spend another $500,000 and then say to the citizens, we don't know what to do, so what do you think we should do? I think it behooves us, and it's our responsibility to take all the information we can gather and make a recommendation. And if people agree with that, then it'll get bonded. If they don't agree with it, we'll stay in this building just as it is and try to paint and patch. And that's what they want to do. That's what we do. But I don't think it's right to say we can't decide, so we're going to go to the public and say, which of these should we take, or you got some other options? And it's just going to go on and on and round and round.
Well, I think the community has to decide that they want to support having a city hall. And so that's one of my concerns. And to build it in a tsunami zone, I think, is not a good idea. Why throw good money after bad?
Why stay here and die?
Right. Well, don't build a building that isn't going to make it because the tsunami that we're anticipating is going to be bigger than, anyway, I just think it's a bad idea to rebuild in this zone.
Ideally, we would love to build in a very safe zone for city halls. We just don't have something that's ideal. Southland is not ideal. Make it much safer than this building or a building on this area. You're going to pay a premium of, exactly what it was, $15 up to $28 million. That's a big insurance premium to pay. Would that be the first thing you'd propose to ask the citizens? Are you willing to pay that premium?
Would you have to rebuild it when the tsunami comes? So that you might as well subtract that from what this is, because you're going to have to do it again.
Yeah, let me ask you this. You going to move your house? So it's a question answered. What is it we want done? I'm not going to go to the city or to the citizens and say, I propose that we go out and bond for $28 million. Bigger than that now, almost $30 million. I won't do that. I think I wouldn't vote for it, and I wouldn't ask anybody else to vote for it. So the question is, we look at something that's not as expensive, that is much better than this, would survive earthquake, and would survive the modest tsunami, and the 13, $14 million cheaper.
And to Robin's point, when, and I hope I have my numbers right, they evaluated 15 different strengths of events that were likely to occur, and I think 12 of them were below, they were medium or below tsunamis, not the extra large. And so if we were to build her here and build to a category 4 and raise the second floor of it, then we wouldn't be, you know, a total washout on a tsunami other than the one that was going to make it almost all the way up to Southwind anyway. So it's not a, we build it here and then it's a total loss for the first time we have an event. We're going to be good for most events. It's just we won't build necessarily to the ultimate. And we can build to the ultimate. We can go ahead and build up at Southwind and cover that. There's an upcharge. And the question is how much you're going to do. But when we're talking about, you know, will people vote for it or are those things, again, you have to give some criteria that says this is why we're building it. This is what it'll do for you. This is what it will cost, and let people make the decision. And when people make the decision, again, I've done this 3 times, they make the decision based on what it will cost them. Not necessarily, the difference between $12 million and $16 million, both of those are outrageous to me. But I'm not being asked to pay that. I will pay based on what my, you know, per thousand or per 100,000 or whatever the number is. And then when you, as the council, say, this is what you will get for. We will have a building. We'll be able to go ahead and start operations immediately. Or if we don't, we won't. And you know, and I made a case that this, there's nobody on staff who's looking for a new building. It's whether or not the citizens want us to be able to go ahead and provide a high level of protection if something happens. Because you know, when I got here, everybody was very adamant about the importance of emergency management. And what we have to do as a city is not necessarily have a bunch of people out there, you know, with shovels and things like that. We have to manage others. And so it's a facility to go ahead and be able to do that. We'll do it without it. But you have to decide, and I've seen it, it's hard. Like what you folks have to do is policy. It's harder than operations. You know, we can site buildings and all that kind of stuff. That's relatively easy. But deciding why you're going to do it and then saying, that's why we're talking about this. And yes, this number is 16. Yes, this number is 12. This is what it's going to cost you. So that's that's how, ultimately, when we talk about being out into November, whatever, that's how it would work. But first thing you got to decide if it's worth doing, and if it is, why. That's your criteria.
If we just replace this building with a one-story building, what Robin's bringing up is a very valid point. It's all on one level, and it's all going to be flooded. But for another $1.5 million, you can, and we'll be at risk whether we can even serve the community after that. Another $1.5 million at this site, you're going to have the ability to respond much more quickly and effectively. This site, if you have the Cascadia event, you're not going to be surviving anywhere.
And when we're talking about, again, I'm going to my
led in Utah. But if you were to say, well, let's go ahead and go for the $14 million, I would say don't do it. Because $14 million is going to be a category, will be a category two, and it'll be a building that will survive until we can get out. And it'll be better than this. We won't. But I don't think that's, with everything that's going on, I don't think that's a worthy expenditure of the residents. I think that if you're going to do this, you need to do it so that there is a real benefit if something happens. Because we replace this building with a Category 2, and it's going to be wiped out in a, it's not going to be tsunami resistant, and it's not going to be earthquake resistant. I would not recommend you do that.
I'd go ahead and take option A right off the table.
I like Bruce's comment or consideration that we should set up criteria. I think to me that makes, it frames what we're talking about. We set up the criteria. A couple of the items that Mike has put forward, recovery after a significant event, City Hall safe for personnel, economically feasible, those are criteria. I would throw in some minor ones about the aesthetics and the character of Cana Beach and stuff like that, because that follows the vision of Cana Beach. And we could have a whole list of criteria. And I would hope that next week, when we do this again, I will be asking for public comment, in-depth public comment, and we can get more criteria, even ones that we haven't even thought of. That would be my hope. So I think we will get some public input prior to this. One of the things I realized, putting forward, being, you know, kind of assertive and saying this is the what the council wants, and putting forward one option, when you know that there are other options out there, especially if we put that forward as the bond specifically, without having at least analyzed all the other possibilities with the public, so that they can bring forward some ideas. I think that's really important. Got lost there. So.
You say economically feasible. What is your definition of economically feasible?
My definition is somewhere there's a balance to where people in the community will say, yes, that's important enough to pay for. Sometimes it's way out here. I think the $29 million is like way out there. It says that's a pie in the sky. No way. Whereas you could literally say that the cheapest option might not be the one that they want. They might want the one somewhere in the middle. And they'd be willing to squeeze a little bit harder to go for, as long as it's exactly what fits. And it is a reasonable option. It looks logical. It fits our criteria that we were going to put forward. And it is understandable. Even this breakdown that Bruce has given us, I think, is probably one of the most understandable breakdowns of all of the financial stuff that's come through. For me, because it gives me a today's dollar representation. It also breaks out some of the elements of the construction that are confusing. I still see that, and I could be looking at it from my perspective of, damn, that stuff's expensive. But, you know, things are more expensive than when I built my house. So I understand, yes, things get more expensive. But I also know that there are structures out there that cost less. So I don't know. I would like to make sure that we have covered all our bases when we come to find out this is a more efficient cost factor. That's kind of where I'm getting to with what is economically feasible, is that maybe the 14 or the 15 million is doable, even though a 10 million or a 7 million might come about. You know, there might be a way to bring up something like that. I don't know. that's, I'm just wish thinking here, I think. Bruce?
I give permission to be obstinate again. I'm going through this process. I have a significant concern that if we can't have an explanation of why we're trying to do something, if we can't articulate that to people, then if we have a session when people are coming in, there's no reason for them to be anything but negative. Because there's no benefit, there's no understanding what the benefit might be. So I think that we need to be careful about that, because we can have a very, what appears to be a very negative reaction from the public when we've not given them the opportunity to understand, because we have not had the opportunity and wherewithal to agree on what we're trying to do. So as I'm looking forward to next week, if we can't really articulate this, I would recommend we don't do that until maybe we have another topic like we are now. But I would wait for that until we can articulate better, or else just anticipate that the session will be primarily negative, and then we'll be trying to recover and push back on that.
Bruce, you've had experience with disasters when you were in Florida, and we have all had some knowledge of the Japanese tsunami and the tsunamis in Indonesia. Is there any way of gathering information about how people built back, how they recovered, and what the problems were in their recovery, in terms of gathering records and helping people restore their property and that kind of thing, and how that might relate to us here?
Yeah, and I've been involved with, at least in seminars where they talk about those kind of things, but people will say, well, if this place downtown gets destroyed, no one will come back. That's the farthest from the truth, because people have millions of dollars invested in Georgia. You're going to go ahead and abandon that site. You're going to build something else or sell it or something. So people will come back. So that's going to happen. Now, if it comes back the way you want it, depends on something that I was not anticipating doing for at least another year, and that's to talk about a recovery ordinance. And that would either say that if you have if you have any, what do you call them, nonconformities on your lot, you make a decision. Is somebody able to go ahead and rebuild to that nonconformity, or that they not do it? Are you going to make any other changes as far as the type of construction, the architectural features, that, you know, anything you're going to do different from a zoning standpoint? You do those things in advance, and then you can always kind of modify it. But if people are coming in for building permits, and you don't have anything to work from, then it's not going to work that well. But you can go ahead and think out most of it.
Well, I'm just thinking of, you know, places that have experienced disasters, and don't, you know, do they have a central point? Did they have a central point? Did that work? If they didn't have a central point, what did they do? How did they get records that they needed to continue to rebuild? How, you know, we're talking about using City Hall as an emergency center. Mm-hmm. So where else has there been a disaster, and did they have an emergency center like we are looking at building, and how did that work? Or did it, if they didn't, what did they do? So that we can kind of relate to what has gone on before us.
Yeah, the communities that we're in were a little bit more metro. And so there were places that didn't necessarily have an EOC or an equivalent of a city hall that survived, but they might be able to work out of the county EOC. And also, we kind of were county-centric, that we pretty, everything happened. We were all good with what the county was doing, and we all had a seat at the table, all those kind of things. It's a different situation here. And also, there were so many things were in place, the pre-position contracts, all that. We would just go ahead and call contractors, and they would literally start to move in from around Orlando or someplace, and if the hurricane actually hit us, they were ready to go ahead and come in. If not, they would go ahead and back down. So all those kind of things can be in place. The difference is, as far as like, do you have a place to go ahead and manage Cannon Beach? It'll slow down significantly. I've had comments from people that, hey, all you need is a cell phone and a laptop. Well, as long as I'm here, I took the laptop with me and the cell phone, I'm probably good for 3 or 4 hours. Because if I can't recharge that, if I can't recharge my phone, and I can't get the internet, I really have nothing. And so that's the idea of having a building that is set up so that, yeah, you're going to have, and I think Jim Liveland mentioned this too, is the U.S. satellite, those kind of, but you have that, and you make those decisions to do it. Because if you don't, there will be a period of time, and we have some satellite phones, I don't know how well they work, but we have some of us will have satellite phones. And then every decision that has to be made, every call that has to be made, would happen that way. And one of the things that happens for days is that if I want to see the mayor, I've got to find the mayor. You know, that we're not in a place where we would go ahead and have a meeting. If there's no office here, then if we're trying to go ahead and look for you guys, we have to find you by going out and either walking or driving or whatever it's going to be. So those are the kind of things that, and then you have to have an address for people to come to. If you want, you know, somebody to come in and help you with utility restoration, all that kind of stuff. So you can do it, but we don't have an EOC that's close by. And I don't know the building that we would be able to go to here that would necessarily be survivable that we would go ahead and take over. So we would be at a very low level of operation. I'm talking Puerto Rico, you know, as far as our ability to go ahead and say, okay, we know what we're doing and we're getting this thing done. But the places that did better, and again, because like the Gulf Coast gets hit all the time and the East Coast, is that they're set up, and they're set up with EOCs. Both counties that I work in, the EOCs were set up for Category 5 storms. They were going to survive no matter what it was, and we would all work out of those. That's how important it is to have a place from which to operate.
I guess my next question is, how important do you think, or maybe does the council think, local residents worry about this? How important is it to them that we have something like this? Because that's basically our question. If it's not important to them...
If I can, I don't think most people, this is why we need some time, this is why we need a decision made on what's important. To ask the question, are you willing to support a city hall, what do I have to base that on other than it's going to cost me money? But if people, as we get more into emergency management issues, like we've done a lot of good emergency management stuff, but it's not nearly enough. We're not ready to go ahead and really take care of the community. We have CERT that's going to be able to do some good work. And then we have the MRC, if we can find a place for them to operate from. If we can find them, that they can find, you know, wherever, you know, we're going to meet, we have to still sort out all that kind of stuff. But as far as fixing anything, clearing any roads, all that's just not, we have nothing. It's not going to happen. We have no plan for that. Now, we're working on those kind of things, but if it's going to happen, we have to have some place that is a Category 4 building that we would be able to operate from, that people would be able to come to and say, hey, has anybody seen Robin or whatever. That's the kind of the gathering place that people will find to go ahead and do messages and all that kind of stuff. But you have to have that. And I tried to make the point earlier. It's, Julie, Jason, close your ears again.
Yeah.
It's not about the police. They're going to get all the glory for the Category 4 building and all that kind of stuff, and we'll all ride their coattails. But it's going to be a public works. It's going to be planning. It's going to be from the fireside, people coming in for the rescue. It's going to be finance, making sure that we're tracking everything, and we're submitting bills and all those kind of things to get paid, and us to be able to pay bills so that people will work for us, and for the council to be able to have meetings to go ahead and sort things out. So me, it's like if you either say you're all in, or what you're talking about going to like the smaller plan, like if we were to build a police station, it would be category 4 back here, and it would have a big conference room. We'd have about 20% of what we need, and then everything else would be improvised, because we couldn't get all the people that need to be in there that I'm talking to. We couldn't have all the contractors come in and have that be, you know, a place to work on. We went over and met at the fire station after our last meeting, when I mentioned that the EOC is not really necessarily going to be conducive for us. Well, it's not. There's no consideration for additional power if people are bringing laptops or anything like that in. The amount of their broadband available, we would totally eat it up. Everybody, I mean, the number of people they're going to bring in, firefighters and all that. And if we're trying to go ahead and, you know, talk to anybody, they don't have satellite. They don't have fiber. A lot would have to be done over there before that would even be. But again, it's a room that's about the size, square footage wise, from here over. And that's for all fire functions, all city functions. And I mean, that's, we would make it work. I'll tell you, if we don't build this building, we'll make it work. But if people have a high expectation, we will not meet that expectation. We will not be close. And there'll be a lot of people, angry people, asking why we don't have our act together. And that happened. People get very angry.
Just for reference, the one question you asked about if there was somebody we could ask, Patrick Corcoran, mm-hmm. has been over recently.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't mind having him, not specifically about City Hall discussion, but just have a presentation of what he's doing.
Well, I think, you know, we have to present this situation to the residents. And when you said we're not even there yet, I'm beginning to wonder if we're a little too early to even talk about City Hall. But I mean, if we're going to use it as an emergency operations center, but this is what we need to find out from people, how important they think that function is. Mm-hmm. Because if they're going to think that it's important, then they may be willing to pay the $16 million.
Or whatever it is.
Or whatever.
On their particular bill.
Yeah. Well, right. I mean, that's overall $16 million. But that, I think we have to start from there, is how important do you think this is, and how important is it going to be to you and your family and your neighbors? And then work from that point.
Okay, that gets us back to creating our criteria,
mm-hmm.
so that we can then start elaborating on those points. And obviously, emergency management and care is high on the list. So, and that is the pretty much the hinge of the whole thing. Foundation of the whole thing. So to me, I have a little, again, I fall back on the decision between here, Gower Street Concepts, and the South Wind, is that we have for so long been pushing the fact that we design for the worst case scenario. I can get around that. I'm not sure other folks can as quickly, because I've been working on it for a while. But I had another note here. Hang on. Oh, I'm not even sure if Bruce is aware. We do have a hardened building that would be available for us in a situation. And I don't know if it's Category 4, but I know it's designed pretty heavily. I could talk to you about that later. Coaster.
What about Coaster?
Coaster building. So, in that sense, we would have maybe one option.
Yeah, as long as they know we're coming.
Yeah.
As long as we can get.
And, you know, we had a, I don't know if we had a contract with them at one point. Jason left. We had interaction with them for a while, and I think that's kind of fallen off to the wayside. We need to get that back together.
Put in facilities for water, housing people, yeah. And shelter and supplies. That'd just be part of our overall emergency
operation plan, and they have other sites around the community. But certainly the city council are responsible for providing city services. Station security, sewer, water, drainage, streets, all these things. But the part we're trying to focus on here is the emergency management, and providing a reasonable service at a reasonable cost. And until we present a scope of what we want, the building, you know, what are you going to have there and why do you have it? You can do that even with the figures we have. And this is what we're looking at. And to provide this level of emergency recovery and safety costs this much, we can provide a much higher level, not 100%, but a much higher level for this amount. The facilities will be essentially the same as far as office space and function and so forth. And there's going to be, why does it cost so much? Well, explain that too. And it's going to narrow this down to at least the best option at Gower Street and the best option at Southland. And lay these out. This is the problem. This is what we're trying to address. These are our needs. This is what can happen if we don't do it. This is what you can expect if we do it in Gower Street. Here's what you can expect if we do it at Southland. And here's the expected range of costs at those two locations. And at least get it down from four options to two that are two quite different. It will not end up looking like either one of those, but it'll be somewhere in that neighborhood. Because we're not going to do a complete detailed design with the citizens. But you have to have something you can show them. This is these two options we're looking at. And you'll get that kind of feedback that you're all looking for. And maybe I'll be greatly surprised. Everybody thinks Southland is well worth $30 million, but present it, because that is a level of safety that is the highest that we can possibly come up with. And are you as citizens willing to pay for that? Here's the other option. It meets most of the criteria. It's located here. It'll still be standing after the quake. Bottom level may be flooded, but then received. But we will be able to operate and serve the city from either of these sites. One may be able to serve better after the big event. One will be able to serve better daily. And we don't want to lose sight of serving this community on a day-to-day basis. You walk in with your plans for a building permit, you walk in with your complaint about a water bill, you know, and you say, well, you can still it up in Southland.
Yeah.
Maybe you can.
Okay, I was hoping to... No comments, Doug, sorry. I was hoping to cut this off in an hour. Do you all feel like we've talked about this enough? Want to continue?
Maybe the council could write down. I think to, you know, go back to your opening remarks. We need to establish the criteria. Why are we doing this?
I've kept some notes here of what we've been talking about and kind of figured out which ones are the, so far. I will pass that on to Bruce. And you can send it out to everybody. If anybody else wants to do the same thing,
mm-hmm.
You're welcome to. And Bruce can compile it into one big, long list of criteria. That would probably be very effective, at least for us. Does that work?
I can put, give me the information, put you.
Okay.
with that, we'll close for tonight.
Well, I'd like to know what we're doing next week, what we're expected, what is planned for next week. Are we going to take public testimony? Because apparently somebody wanted to speak. But
yeah, I think we should. And I want, you know, I know last time I opened up the floor, but that was for specific questions for Lisa. Next week, on Wednesday, I would like to get as many folks as possible to make comments. I think we're still, you know, at a point where this is not a citywide survey type drama kind of question. I think we're just trying to see if we're heading in the right way. And I'm sure there's some new ideas out there that we haven't even touched on. So that's where I'm coming from. Okay? Okay, then we will go to the order. Anything that we need to talk about for any other topic? Nope, I will adjourn. Thank you.